It's very important to the process of understanding Google Cloud and passing the certification exam that you go through the question and attempt answering it yourself first. So pause the video, work through the question. We'll catch up in just a little while and I'll show you how I do it. In this project scenario, you are building a new real-time data warehouse for your company and will use Google BigQuery streaming inserts. There is no guarantee that data will only be sent in once, but you do have a unique ID for each row of data and an even timestamp. You want to ensure that duplicates are not included while interactively querying data. Which query type should you use? So in this situation, we know we are using Google BigQuery, which is the right choice for a data warehouse. We have to support streaming inserts also. There is no guarantee that the data sent won't be repeated, but we can distinguish each row by a unique ID and an event timestamp. So even if there are repeats, there's a way to identify those repeats. When we are querying data, we want to ensure that duplicates are excluded. Now we need to figure out the option which suits that best. While doing this, we are going to take a simple example that will help us figure out which of these would be the appropriate option. So in this case, there is data with the IDs 1, 2, and 3. And you can see that the entry with ID 1 is repeated twice. In the output, we want to ensure that there's only one entry for each of the IDs. So that's what we should get after we run the query. Now let's consider each of the options that we have. The first one suggests that we do an order by descending on the timestamp column and limit to 1. Now, as soon as I hear the limit to 1, I'm like, okay, that can't work because ultimately you'll end up having only one row. But what do we need? We need to have 3 rows at the end of it. Let's try this anyway. If we first do an order by descending on the timestamp column, we are going to get data with the time going in a descending order. So we will have grouping in terms of ID based on time. If the IDs were same, this time also is going to be the same. So those grouping will be fairly fair. However, when we apply a limit to one option, we are going to have only the first row from the intermediate output. Therefore, option A is not what we want, and we can exclude that. Option B suggests that we group by on the unique ID column and timestamp column, and then sum the values. In our case, the values are the data. So the first operation is to group by on the unique ID column and timestamp. That will work. Given that the ID and the time are going to be corresponding with each other, we are able to get these groups of data, and we've grouped the ones with the ID 1, the ones with ID 2, the ones with ID 3, and so on. However, what is the point of doing a sum on the values? If you do a sum on the values now, it is going to sum these two entries, and then it is going to keep this separate because there is no other group for this, and this is also independent. So the output in this case is going to be a summation of the data or the values, as the question suggests, in the output. That definitely is not correct. That's not what we want. Therefore, option B also should be eliminated. Now, looking at the two remaining options, let me be honest with you that I am not very good at analytic functions on SQL or on Google BigQuery. I've not done that too much. I have a somewhat understanding of it, but I'm not very strong on it. So when I did this answer, I realized that without knowing this part, you wouldn't be able to do very well. Therefore, I recommend that you go learn the window clause about analytic functions with navigation, numbering, and aggregate analytic functions also. That would be important for the exam. Just by looking at these options, I was not able to immediately figure out what would be the right option, given things that I didn't know, like a lag window or a row number. Now, I kind of knew it, but I was not very sure about it. So you should be going and learning something more regarding analytic functions. I've done a little research now, and based on that, here is my response. We'll first try out the lag window function. We're going to partition by unique ID, and we're going to set the lag is not none. Now, what does the lag window function do? According to the description, it returns a value of the value expression that you set on a preceding row. What does that mean? If we set to partition by unique ID, then we are going to have these partitions kind of like a group. So we get these separate partitions because we are grouping, partitioning by unique ID. Then when we set a lag window on this, it is going to check with the previous rows that were there in that partition. So in this case, the partition is going to be, the previous row in this case, the lag window in this case is going to have a null entry. The same thing over here, it is also going to have a null entry in the lag window. Over here though, this one will have a null entry, but this will have this row, the first row, as its previous row. So the lag for the second row, this one, is going to be this. If therefore we eliminated the null entries over here, where the lag is null, then it is going to remove row one, which means we will end up only with the second one, which is of course a duplicate, so that would be fine. However, if we set the lag to not null, we will now have these two entries being removed because its lag is going to be null. So the final output in this case is going to be just this entry, which is not what we want. Therefore, we are going to have to eliminate option C also. How about option D now? Option D suggests that we use a row number window function with partition by unique ID and where row equals 1. What the row number function does is to add a sequential row ordinal, 1 base, it starts off from 1, for each row of the ordered partition. So what does that mean? If we do a row number for each of these entries, partitioned by the ID, we are going to have a partition of 1, a partition of 2, and a partition of 3. For each of these now, it is going to append a column called row in our query, which is going to sequentially number it starting from 1. So this partition will have the row entries 1 and 2. This partition will have the row entry 1. This partition will have the row entry 1. Now we're filtering by where row equals 1, which means we will get one entry from this partition, one entry from this partition, and one entry from the third partition. This is finally the output that we want. And of course, these are not going to come out as partitions. They're going to come out as a regular row results from a select query. Therefore, with this, we will get the right answer that we want, and therefore D would be the appropriate option to choose. So the right approach in this is to use the row number window function with partitioning on the unique ID and select the first one from that. If you're interested in picking up loads more learning on Google Cloud, go ahead and subscribe right away.